Greenpeace flagship Rainbow Warrior sails into New Zealand. It's the end of a four-month voyage across the Pacific Ocean.
New Zealand at the time was a nuclear-free zone, which made it almost feel like coming home when we arrived in Auckland, and there was such a mood on the boat. So it was really exciting to go in there, and it was the place to go.
Well, we had a great reception in Auckland. Yeah, we had a whole bunch of boats came out to meet us, and we had a great reception on the wharf. So that was fantastic, really. You know, we were all ready to go.
It was a nice day. It was a very nice day. It was cold. And there was lots of boats out on the harbour, and they were flying banners, and people were yelling at us and waving, and yeah, that was quite extraordinary.
The whole atmosphere in New Zealand was very much for a nuclear-free Pacific, and the Rainbow Warrior was something of an icon, as a symbol. Even then, people looked to the upcoming voyage that was going to happen and across to Mororoa, that the Rainbow Warrior was going to be the flagship for that protest fleet, and so there's a lot of expectation and hope.
Almost unnoticed, some French tourists arrive in New Zealand. A couple on their honeymoon. A backpacker with nowhere to stay. A businessman in a downtown hotel. And four sailors on a chartered yacht. Their boat carries diving equipment and underwater explosives.
Two explosions have destroyed the Greenpeace protest vessel.
Sank at her berth at Marsden Wharf.
The crew says the first blast
was missing after sinking, and his body was found by police divers. Diving and explosives experts will today continue intensive.
Police believe the bombs were sophisticated devices and say international terrorists may have been involved.
A Portuguese member of the crew was killed.
His body was later found in the hull of the boat. All other members on board.
Stunned Greenpeace members say the vessel was priceless. But right now, they're still mourning for their dead colleague who went down with the vessel.
Photographer Fernando Pereira is dead. The Rainbow Warrior is wrecked beyond repair. Someone is determined to stop Greenpeace sailing for Mururoa.
It's a bomb from who? You know, the question came up. And could be the Russians or the Chinese or the Japanese whalers or... and all the enemies we have made over the years.
As the story unfolds, the world is shocked at what a supposedly friendly, democratic country will do to silence its critics.
We were appalled. We couldn't imagine that a government that had been on the same side in the Second World War would actually carry out an act of sabotage in New Zealand waters.
It's a story of state-sponsored terrorism, of political cover-up, and of the race for nuclear domination. It's a story that won't go away.
There was, about the whole nuclear issue, an awful political cynicism being used by great powers who were prepared to advance their interests over the interests of anyone else, including killing a person. The ultimate cynical manipulation for selfish interest that I have ever seen or experienced in my time.
It's the story of the boat and the bomb. Greenpeace has come a long way since the first voyage to protest against American nuclear tests.
The waters of the North Pacific are often treacherous, and only a couple of the crew members had ever been to sea. In April 1975, 20,000 supporters watched Greenpeace set out from Vancouver to scour the North Pacific for the whalers.
Greenpeace opens offices in the US, Canada, and Europe. But it needs a bigger, faster ship.
Since February 1978, the Greenpeace organization has been planning their anti-whaling strategy. They've purchased this aging, rusty trawler with a grant from the Netherlands branch of the World Wildlife Fund. And for the next 3 months, Greenpeace volunteers will be working flat out to get it in fighting trim. Though no formal declaration has been made, this is without doubt a preparation for battle on the high seas.
For the next 7 years, the Rainbow Warrior sees action across the world. She attracts trouble and headlines. Intercepted by Icelandic gunboats.
Yes, answer is yes, you are under arrest.
Rammed by the French Navy. Detained under armed guard in Spain for 5 months before a dramatic nighttime escape. By 1985, Greenpeace is ready to mount its most ambitious and potentially dangerous mission yet.
We're right now going back to our roots. We started against nuclear testing, and we feel very strongly that governments such as USSR, United States, France, UK, China, must stop testing as the first step towards disarmament.
Well, we had been working for a couple of years, actually ever since the Rainbow Warrior came to North America in the beginning of 1981, about putting together a voyage to the Pacific and taking the Warrior to Mururoa. We had just restarted the nuclear weapons testing campaign in 1981, and that was going to be a feature.
France has been testing nuclear weapons on the island of Mururoa since 1962.
Nous nous trouvons ici exactement au point zéro de l'explosion, c'est-à-dire au centre de l'atoll. Au-dessus de nous se trouve le ballon et sous le ballon, la nacelle dans laquelle prendra place la bombe.
The first bombs were slung under a balloon and exploded in mid-air. After protests in the early 70s, the tests go underground. By 1985, more than 100 nuclear explosions have rocked Mururoa.
That was all happening in our neighbourhood, in the Pacific, in other words, and we said, no, no, no. If you want to test, do it in your own backyard. You know, if you're the French and the British, go and try the Mediterranean. If you're so keen, you think it's so safe, go over there.
Each blast causes the island to sink by a couple of centimetres.
They keep blowing the tests off underground, and they've made a lot of mistakes. In fact, they've blown the side of the atoll right off. They've got a crack in the side of the atoll that's about a half a mile long and about a foot wide. Radiation is spewing into the ocean.
Tests show increased levels of plutonium in the ocean. Even the fish are radioactive.
There's a lot of Polynesian people on the islands around there that you can't get to, and there's a lot of cancer, there's a lot of health problems in French Polynesia and across the Pacific from that. But now they're testing underground, and they are testing neutron bombs. And they're just turning that island, that atoll, into a just Swiss cheese. They're blowing it to smithereens.
MacTaggart has unfinished business at Mururoa. In 1972, he sails his yacht Vega into the French exclusion zone. Together with Nigel Ingram and Gene Horn, he aims to stop the French testing another nuclear bomb.
I've done some pretty crazy things, but I'm really against all this stuff. Vietnam, apartheid, and other things don't really excite me too much. But atomic bombs, I just think they're ridiculous. So, Mom and Dad, please try to understand. That's about it.
After a month, the French Navy lose patience. They ram the yacht and arrest the crew. The Vega returns to Mururoa the following year. The French are worried. They've already tried to bribe MacTaggart with an offer of $5,000 to keep away.
And they came up alongside, and three of them jumped up on the side of the deck, and I went to the front one, the one in the middle, and told him, you know, not to get on my boat. We're in international waters. And they just let me have it. And they pulled my shirt over my head. I went right over the side of the boat into the inflatable, and they started beating on me. And they had sort of batons, they had knives, they had guns, and they kept beating on me for about 2 or 3 minutes, and then one of them just pulled my head up and smashed the butt end of the truncheon into my eye, and I went out cold. And then they were smashing Nigel, who was in the cockpit. He'd just come out from below, and they started smashing him, and they hit him in the neck. They broke the bones in the back of his neck. He fell down in the cockpit. They were kicking him in the groin. They went after Mary, a New Zealand girl who was shooting with a Super 8. They took that camera and threw it over the side, and Anne-Marie, another New Zealand girl, was up forward shooting with an Nikon, black and white. She got 13 pictures off, then dove down underneath the boat, hid the camera, and we had another camera set up, and they found that. They came smashing down below. They ripped the film out, and they thought they had the film.
Greenpeace doesn't forget about Mururoa.
When we restarted the campaign against nuclear testing in 1981, others in the disarmament community in Washington and elsewhere said, what are you, crazy? Because they were all exercised about the cruise missiles at the time. And they said, nuclear testing? Oh, why do you bother? Well, nobody cares about nuclear testing. Which, to a certain extent, was true. Nobody did care about nuclear testing. Except we did.
The Pacific campaign means a new look for the Rainbow Warrior.
Finally got approval to put the sailing rig on the ship in about June of 1984, which transformed this clunky old North Sea trawler into one of the most fuel-efficient long-range 130-foot motorboats you could possibly imagine. Basically gave us unlimited capacity to stay at sea.
She was in Jacksonville, and a decision was made to have the vessel for longer periods in the Pacific, and that a sailing rig would be very good for the vessel, long distances, good image, you know, saving fossil fuels, etc.
Greenpeace can now mount a sustained campaign against the French.
The atmosphere on the boat was solid. We had just spent a 6-month period in Jacksonville, Florida, that was as tough as anything I've ever done in Greenpeace, where we put the sailing rig on the boat, working in in the back of a muddy field underneath a highway. And we were so glad to get out of there, so glad to get to the tropics, Mururoa, the far Pacific.
What happens next proves to be a turning point in Greenpeace history.
A group of people on Wrangelup had been exposed to the biggest test of all, a bomb that was 1,000 times more powerful than Hiroshima.
On March the 1st, 1954, the U.S. detonates a 15-megaton hydrogen bomb on Bikini Atoll. It's codenamed Bravo.
They had no warning. They didn't know it was happening. And they woke to two sunrises, one in the east and one in the west.
End result was a massive radioactive cloud which just drifted over the whole of the northern Marshall Islands and came down in a snow.
And they got all this radioactive material snowing down on them.
Basically, they were used as guinea pigs by U.S. authorities to see what radiation will do to human beings. They had a long legacy of cancers and childbirth problems, serious problems. The woman on the island were becoming very afraid for the future of their children.
So they got to the point where they asked to be moved. They asked their own government, they asked the U.S. government. And when we went out there in 85, they also asked us if we wouldn't help move them off the island. We said, of course.
So we got there and they're disassembling their houses, piling up the tin roofs and the pieces of plywood on the beach, and the pigs and chickens and the community buildings and all of their personal possessions and all the rest of it were ferried by inflatable from the beach to the boat and piled on.
This was the first, and as it turns out, the last time that Greenpeace has ever moved a people, as it were. And it's an extremely ambitious thing to have contemplated and done, and also a high risk strategy, because you don't know whether it will work.
We had too much gear on board and the wind had blown up and there were too many people, and we really felt that it wasn't safe to rig the sails. That was the bad trip, when every Marshallese on the boat was seasick. And the whole crew spent the entire night of the passage mopping up after everyone.
Greenpeace photographer Fernando Pereira records the evacuation.
Not very much bothered him. He was a very good photographer.
It was very easy for him to get close to subjects and stuff like that. You know, you could see that he had a good way of meeting people.
Yeah, he was charming too. He was a real charmer, Fernando.
The Pacific campaign is Fernando's longest assignment yet. It means months away from his family in Amsterdam.
My memory of my dad leaving for the airport, taking him to the airport with my mom and my brother by car, waving him goodbye in front of the big entrance doors, telling him not to go, because me saying to him, you're not coming back for one reason or another. My dad obviously saying, of course I'll be back, just take care of your mom. I'll do my trip and I'll be home soon. Never realizing that that would be the last time I'd see him.
The Rongelap mission is a success, but it's time to go.
It was a bit of a wrench to leave. A lot of the crew said, well, we can't leave now. I said, well, our job really here is done. We can't rebuild their community for them. They have to do it for themselves, and plus we need to get to Auckland because we're due first in Rarotonga and then Mururoa.
The Rainbow Warrior heads south. Her final destination is Mururoa, and another confrontation with the French.
We were all excited about the Mururoa campaign. I mean, it was a good year, a good, tough, exciting year on the boat.
The Rainbow Warrior heads south to New Zealand. It's her last stop before Mururoa.
We're going to be joined by this peace flotilla, this nuclear free flotilla from New Zealand. And they were, at the time, there were like, I think, eight boats or something lined up.
Remembering the history of all the Vega voyages that had started from New Zealand, it just seemed like the place to go.
It's an ambitious plan. Greenpeace aims to stop French nuclear bomb tests in the Pacific.
We'd had this dream that had been slowly concocted over a number of meetings over a number of years of actually getting there with the Rainbow Warrior and with the new sail rig. It would have virtually unlimited staying power. And that was the one thing that very clearly drove the French crazy.
France is determined. The tests will go ahead.
François Mitterrand went against all his promises as leader of the left. He was the French president who detonated the most atomic bombs. France has never exploded so many nuclear weapons.
The French Secret Service, the DGSE, wants to make sure the Rainbow Warrior never reaches Mururoa. Defense Minister Charles Hernault gives the go-ahead.
L'opération a reçu son nom de code.
The operation was given the code name Satanique. Of course, it was a strange name, but it wasn't particularly significant.
Pour nous, aucune signification particulière.
François Mitterrand, the socialist president, who goes back on his promise to stop nuclear tests.
The decision was made clearly to perpetrate the sabotage in New Zealand, in a New Zealand harbour, in a supposedly friendly country. And I expect because of our clear sympathy to the non-nuclear stance.
Mitterrand denies knowledge of the plot, but many believe he too approves Operation Satanique.
Qui a donné l'ordre?
Who gave the order? Did the president know? I'm one of those who are convinced that François Mitterrand did know. Maybe not the details, but he knew about the operation. That means he gave his go-ahead.
A young Frenchwoman calling herself Frédérique Bonlieu calls at the Greenpeace office in Auckland. She offers her services as a volunteer.
Infiltrating Greenpeace is like infiltrating the YMCA. It's just not very tough, and I think that's one of our strengths. I mean, we're not this super secretive organization. We're pretty open about what we do and how we do it.
Bonnier's real name is Christine Carbon. She's a captain of the French army who's seen active service in the Middle East.
They'd had a rather unusual French woman in their midst for some time. She'd arrived, she had been friendly, she'd been admitted into their group, if you like, which is an open, friendly group of people.
The charter yacht, Uvea, arrives illegally in the far north of New Zealand. On board are three Navy combat frogmen, Roland Verge, Jean-Michel Bartello, and Gerald Adris, work for the DGSE. All are using false identities. The fourth member of the Uvea crew is the only one travelling under his real name. Dr. Xavier Maniguet is a specialist in treating diving accidents. Parangaranga Harbour is remote and lonely. It's ideal for unloading the Uvea's secret cargo. Scuba gear, an inflatable Zodiac boat, outboard engine, and underwater explosives are smuggled ashore. But the yacht's arrival doesn't go unnoticed.
The Uvea was mentioned to us by customs as a vessel we might be interested in. It had been stolen at some time, and customs had it on their records for that reason. And they thought, well, this could be a connecting factor here.
Honeymoon couple, Sophie and Alain Tourange, fly into Auckland. Only later are they exposed as Major Alain Maffar and Captain Dominique Prieur of the French Secret Service. Both are traveling on fake Swiss passports. They hire a camper van with plenty of room for diving gear, bombs, and an inflatable boat. Operation Satanique leaves nothing to chance.
Le choix de la charge qui sera employée.
What sort of bomb should we use against the Rainbow Warrior? It's a crucial question. We were experts in the effects of explosive on ships and harbors. We knew exactly how to make them work.
Nous avons la capacité de les adapter à l'effet recherché.
Two more agents lie low on South Island, Alain Tonnel and Jacques Camourier. Of the backup team. Colonel Louis-Pierre Dillet is head of Operation Satanique. His hotel room overlooks Marsden Wharf. Two days before the bombing, the French team meet near Auckland. The date and time of the attack is agreed. The fate of the Rainbow Warrior is sealed.
It
Il serait plus simple de saboter le
It would have been much easier to bomb the Rainbow Warrior while she was out at sea. But from the start, we had one unbreakable rule. No one must be killed.
Pas de mort.
A friend of us got murdered. It was pure out murder. They didn't give us any warning.
We were sitting inside and that first bomb went off. We were just having our drinks and stuff. And suddenly this bomb went off and it was like sitting in your chair, lights go off, total fucking darkness, like, what is going on?
I didn't really realize what it was. I just woke up and I thought we'd been in a collision with another boat at sea.
The sound was actually kind of a weird sound, you know, not type of sound you immediately think, hey, this is a bomb, you know. It's just a bang, you know. And it's obvious it was from the engine room.
So we just filed out on deck and bang, second one. Second explosion went in a different place, aft. So, and straight away the ship started listing and going down.
And that's when the second bomb went off. And it went off right under our feet.
Andy was on the top step when the second bomb went off, and Fernando was behind him. It collapsed the entire wooden structure around the staircase and trapped him below, and he was drowned.
First one was to create a lot of damage. Second one was there to knock the ship off, you know, to end it, make sure she wouldn't sail.
Stood there looking at the boat with all these bubbles coming up out of it and thing. And that's when Davy Edward, the chief engineer, came up to me and said, well, Fernando's down there.
We were still sort of talking about, oh, well, he probably went to the pub and, you know, and just waiting that he might turn up, which of course he didn't.
It wasn't for till the Navy divers actually came, which was, I'm guessing, 3, 4 hours later, and they found Fernando and I identified him.
We were playing a game outside, standing in a circle playing with the ball with my friends, and then one of our teachers came up to me and asked if I could join her. By the time that I got to my mom, she was in tears. The moment that she said that he was missing, all the pieces fell together, and I cried together with my mom.
That there's a casualty, you know, there's some, I call that a murder, you know, really. I don't call that like an accident.
Well, the first morning it seemed likely that the Rainbow Warrior had been sunk by means of an accidental explosion from inside the ship.
The initial inquiry centered on the explosion itself and the hole inside of the ship. And the big question was it from the inside or from the out?
They took me up to the police station. They had serious concerns that we had done it ourselves up to that point.
They basically said to us, okay guys, when and how are you going to get your ship off of the bottom of my harbor?
When the divers got down and had a proper look, they found that the damage had been caused from the outside of the ship, and therefore, obviously, it had been sabotaged.
This must be sabotage. This sounds crazy. This, you know, it has to be. And then thinking, well, how is it? No one's going to believe us. You know, this is too crazy.
And they said, do you think it was the French? I said, couldn't have been the French. They wouldn't be that stupid.
The agents leave a trail of clues.
Some newspaper commenters said that all that was missing was a beret, a baguette, and a bottle of Beaujolais.
We started to get a mountain of information about what they'd been doing there, you know, where they'd been, where they'd stayed, and in fact, who they seemed to have met.
They were terrible. I mean, they left a trail all over New Zealand, and it was a bit like, I don't know, one of those Pink Panther or Inspector Clouseau movies where they just, yeah, they were completely inept. And I think incredibly arrogant.
We watched the news every night, and it was just unfolding. Every night it was the first headline, you know, for like a month. It was on and on and on and on, the Rainbow Warrior.
France denies responsibility, but nothing can stop the rumours.
It became evident that there was a strong French connection, to the point where we were quite surprised at the amount of evidence that was actually being generated to indicate a French connection.
It was a curious story in the sense that it was pretty obvious from the beginning that it was an outside agency that had caused the explosion. And the French were the obvious candidates.
Detectives questioned the crew of the Auvergne.
We didn't have sufficient evidence to hold them and get an extradition warrant. They disappeared, they were hidden away from us, and we never had access to them again.
The remaining French agents slipped quietly out of New Zealand.
All of them were involved in the operation, and all four of them, as far as I'm concerned, should be questioned for murder.
The Rainbow Warrior is beyond repair. Film taken in dry dock shows the force of the blasts. The engine room clock stopped at the time of the first explosion. Holes torn by flying shrapnel. The Swiss honeymoon couple, Sophie and Alain Tourange, are soon exposed as French agents.
The comment was made by one of the interviewers that he thought that they were spies.
It became evident that the Touranges were probably French rather than Swiss. Then, of course, we thought it has to be a French organisation, and the DGSE seemed to be the logical one.
Been announced in New Zealand that two people have been arrested and charged with murder in connection with the sinking of the Greenpeace ship Rainbow Warrior.
A pair of French-speaking tourists with Swiss passports.
They appeared in a stringently secured...
Evidence points to a conspiracy hatched in Paris.
The lies from the Ministry of Defense, the military, and the presidential cabinet were pushing Mitterrand into a dead end. Because sooner or later, the truth would come out, and Mitterrand himself would be in a lot of trouble.
The pressure is on the French government to come clean. Journalists sense a story which leads directly to Mitterrand.
I think that he will carry to his grave the secret as to whether he knew about the mission to sink the Warrior. I have no evidence that he knew. I am certain that he knew afterwards, and long before France admitted to it.
France denies bombing the Rainbow Warrior, but Operation Satanique is exposed.
Why did they continue to lie when it was revealed very early on that the Touranges were the French agents Maffat and Prieur? Why did they continue to lie when we knew that the Auvergne carried agents from the DGSE? Still, they kept on lying.
The involvement of a section of the French intelligence service is now dominating French radio, television, and newspapers.
Respected French newspaper Le Monde claims two French army frogmen blew up the ship and escaped by plane on the minister's direct
orders. The finger points very straight at one branch of the secret services called the DGSE.
The French government is, of course, involved.
The head of the DGSE, Admiral Pierre Lacoste, is sacked. Defense Minister Charles Arnault resigns.
That shows you just how stupid military people can be. One destructive, killing act against an unarmed, defenseless ship killed a member of its crew and sealed in place the very policy they were fighting so hard to overcome.
Held inside Mount Eden Jail in Auckland, Mafar and Prier are charged with conspiracy, arson, and murder.
Nous sommes pétrifiés.
We were terrified and appalled. We hadn't come here to kill anyone, least of all one of these inoffensive environmental activists. For me, the death of a man was very hard to take.
The trial of the French agents attracts worldwide media attention. The reporters sense a scandal. But a last-minute plea bargain sees Mafar and Prieur plead guilty to manslaughter and arson. The trial is over in less than an hour.
The people who had actually done the bombing had escaped, and the French were sheltering them.
Back in court for sentencing, Mafar and Prieur are confident. At worst, they expect deportation and a heavy fine.
Today in Auckland, sentences of 10 years jail were imposed on two French secret agents who pleaded guilty to involvement in the bombing of the Rainbow Warrior last
France's
July.
France's tactic was to indicate its concern about the two agents.
Mafar and Prieur are shocked. 10 years in jail, to be served in New Zealand.
Do you think justice has been done here today?
Mr. Mitterrand said he would call for justice at the highest level. I think this was reasonable justice at a very low level.
But the agents needn't worry. Mitterrand threatens a trade boycott unless they're released.
New Zealand Prime Minister David Longhi has said he might be prepared to repatriate two jailed French secret agents to one of France's overseas territories.
Today it's announced that Mr. Longhi's government will accept compensation and it will release the agents into French custody.
People were extremely disappointed and felt, you know, we're being pushed around here, we're being bullied by a government that is not abiding by the basics of international ethics. That was a shock. That was a learning experience.
The UN brokers a deal. The French government is forced to apologize. They pay Greenpeace $8 million compensation. Another $13 million goes to the New Zealand government.
It was very unpopular with a lot of New Zealanders. We felt that it was a selling out, really. And even if those who could understand why this happened, they still felt it was complete capitulation to France, and it shouldn't have happened.
Less than 3 years after the attack on the Rainbow Warrior, Prieur and Mafar are back home.
Letting so many French agents escape jail, then that's not justice. Not in our eyes, not in my family's eyes, and I hope not in the world's eyes. And it's never too late for justice.
I feel a sense of total betrayal because they behaved with consistent dishonesty, consistent treachery, and totally in breach of their word. 4 years of lies, broken promises, pressure, and deceit.
The last voyage of the Rainbow Warrior. Thank you.
hardest part of that whole operation was losing Fernando. I hope his children are doing well. That's something that's always been a question mark in my mind.
I'm mad at the French government. It's still unacceptable for me and the family that they bombed the Rainbow Warrior.
New life springs from the old wreck.
It's an inspiring story where a small group of people entered into bearing witness to the nuclear tests, not knowing what the outcome would be.
With the bombing and the tragic death of Fernando, the Rainbow Warrior took on a role in the country's life, an icon that gave it confidence and a sort of sense of self-worth and self-vision in a nuclear-free Pacific.
The old Rainbow Warrior never did make it to Mururoa, but the French plan backfires badly.
Suddenly people were asking the questions, well, why would the French go to these lengths?
You don't have to be very bright to know if you bomb your enemies, turns them into martyrs.
Certainly it made Greenpeace's name, it put it on the map.
It turned it from a relatively small fringe organisation into a multinational organisation.
The world order is changing. Cold War barriers are coming down. But for France, it's business as usual.
L'affaire Greenpeace montre bien.
The Greenpeace affair revealed a policy which was irresponsible and short-sighted. It was a policy which appeared responsible but took no account of the future.
Greenpeace returns to the Pacific. 7 years after the Auckland bombing, the new Rainbow Warrior is back at Mururoa.
Rainbow Warrior, this is Leroy. Now, on the 26th of March at 6:25 a.m., your boat is inside the French territorial waters of Mururoa. I request you stop immediately and call your boat back.
I am going to Mururoa. I am going to Mururoa.
Mitterrand is under pressure. International opinion is against him.
We really strongly believed in the United Nations. We really strongly believed in multilateralism. And a weapon that is aimed at somebody else but affects us really gets up our nose.
Reluctantly, Mitterrand abandons nuclear tests. France joins the moratorium already announced by the UK, US and Soviet Union.
It certainly put a huge amount of pressure on the French, and also I think the nuclear powers in general realised they had to behave themselves.
A new president with an old policy. In 1995, Jacques Chirac tells the military to resume tests on Mururoa.
9, 8, 7, 6, 5, 4, 3, 2, 1.
It's really hard to believe that, you know, the Cold War is over, the Middle East war is over, it's all over, and here we are testing
We don't need these bombs, you know. Just those few trillionaires making all their money from weapons testing.
I think that, as always, Jacques Chirac made a short-sighted decision. As head of the army, he wanted to mark a change of direction from Mitterrand's military policy. Then he stopped the tests again.
Chirac's decision sparks a wave of anti-French riots across the Pacific. In New Zealand, the Rainbow Warrior prepares to sail once more to Mururoa. 10 years after the bombing, the stage is set for one final dramatic confrontation.
What's your message, if you like, to those on the crew who are sailing to Mururoa again?
Keep your eyes open.
Longhi's warning proves all too accurate.
At around 6:30 a.m, commandos and inflatables stormed the Rainbow Warrior as it entered the main channel into the pass at Mururoa. The commandos broke open the window on the bridge of the Rainbow Warrior and threw tear gas onto the bridge. And commandos entered the lower deck and took an axe to the door of the radio room.
Keep going, lads. Okay,
we get the doors open.
This time there can be no cover-up. Pictures of two separate French attacks are flashed around the world.
They boarded us. There were six inflatables of French commandos decked out in balaclavas and helmets and sort of riot gear. And they took over the bridge and confiscated people's
gear. French authorities say they'll escort the Rainbow Warrior out of Mururoa Atoll after its crew was arrested.
It was very stupid politics, actually, I have to say. We had a real difficult period with the French for about, well, until the end of the testing in 96.
After 30 years and nearly 200 detonations, French nuclear testing in the Pacific comes to an end. Chirac agrees to join the Comprehensive Test Ban Treaty.
It took years, and I was on those voyages with MacTaggart and other people. Subsequently, and eventually it did stop the testing at Mururoa, and it's a remarkable achievement, that.
More than half a century after Hiroshima, the treaty is signed by Russia, China, America, Britain, and France. But even today, the agreement has no legal force.
Well, there's still 30,000 nuclear weapons around the world, and that's still a very scary prospect.
The US, along with 10 other states, still refuses to ratify the Comprehensive Test Ban Treaty.
They're trying to convince us that you can use smaller nuclear weapons in conventional war. And they are driving that. They are driving a new nuclear arms race.
When the French Secret Service bombed the Rainbow Warrior, they thought it would stop the protests. Instead, it caused an international outcry.
They thought that they could stop this by stopping a little boat with a handful of people on board.
I don't know what drives government to do extremely stupid things.
And of course what they did more to focus international attention on what they were doing in the Pacific than anything we could ever have done.
You know, in the great scheme of things, bombing the Rainbow Warrior was about the most stupid thing the French could do.
The attack on the Rainbow Warrior was much more than a public relations disaster for the French. Its consequences are felt to this day.
My family and I pretty much accepted what happened in 85, but that doesn't mean that we're gonna forgive and forget.
In the end, part of me believes that France has still not learned from the Greenpeace affair. Deep down, the attitudes of those governing this country haven't changed.
They've never been sorry about sinking the Warrior. They were sorry in the end about being caught.